Joseph C. Wilson served 22 years in the U.S. Foreign Service under Presidents Ford, Carter, Reagan, Bush, Sr., and Clinton. He served as ambassador to Gabon under President George H.W. Bush, as ambassador to Sao Tome and Principe under President Clinton, as political advisor to the Commander-in-Chief, U.S. Armed Forces Europe during the Bosnia deployment, and as special assistant to President Clinton and senior director for Africa at the National Security Council. In Iraq, he served as acting ambassador in the days just before the 1991 Gulf War, during which time he kept a copy of Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland in his Baghdad office coffee table to silently convey what he would later describe as the weird world that was Iraq at that time, a world in which nothing was what it seemed. Mr. Wilson was in effect brought back to Iraq through a former posting in Niger, and specifically by the famous 10 words President George W. Bush spoke during his 2003 State of the Union address: Saddam Hussein recently sought significant quantities of uranium from Africa. As most everyone here knows, the CIA had previously asked Ambassador Wilson to travel to Niger to investigate such claims, for which he found no evidence. Subsequently, and in evident retaliation, senior Bush administration officials disclosed that Mr. Wilson's wife was an undercover CIA operative. Since these events, the former diplomat Joseph Wilson has emerged as one of the Bush administration's leading critics, both for what he calls the pre-war manipulations of intelligence and for the administration's post-war characterizations of the facts on the ground in Iraq, which he says again invoke comparisons to Alice in Wonderland. Our own government, he wrote in one of a series of pieces in the San Jose Mercury News, has dragged the country down a rabbit hole, all the while trying to convince the American people that life in newly liberated Iraq is not as distorted as it seems. Through these and other articles and on the television and radio talk shows, Ambassador Wilson emerged as an early critic of the war and occupation in Iraq, abandoning language of diplomacy, not to mention of most American punditry. In a piece published on April 6th, 3 days before Baghdad fell, Mr. Wilson wrote from his own sense of history and experience in the region. It's worth quoting from him at some length. If the level of resentment is high, U.S. troops who occupy the country, maybe for years to come, could face guerrilla warfare or terrorist attacks. It might also undermine one of the administration's reasons for going to war, to establish a democracy in Iraq that would create a domino effect in a region populated with authoritarian rulers. It will not be easy to build that model of democracy if a large part of the Iraqi population is hostile or just sullen. Even if the Iraqis are thrilled at the overthrow of Saddam Hussein, that jubilation could wane quickly as the United States passes from the role of liberator to occupier. The Iraqis are a proud people steeped in their history and their contributions to civilization. Again, this was published for readers of the San Jose Mercury News 3 days before Baghdad fell. 5 months later, Ambassador Wilson was among the first in his country to describe the insurgency in Iraq and to warn of the self-fulfilling prophecies of the war against terrorists, where once there were thousands, there are now potentially millions of terrorists and sympathizers who will be drawn into this campaign, he wrote. Invoking the much-hated days of the British imperial presence in the Middle East, he wrote of a pith-helmet imperialism that cannot succeed. And he suggested, unusually in the American press, of additional motivations for the new reach of American empire. A more cynical reading of the agenda of certain Bush advisors, wrote Joseph Wilson, could conclude that the balkanization of Iraq was always an acceptable outcome because Israel would then find itself surrounded by small Arab countries worried about each other instead of forming a solid bloc against Israel. Joseph Wilson is the author of the forthcoming diplomatic memoir, The Politics of Truth, Inside the Lies That Led to War and Betrayed My Wife's CIA Identity. He lives in Washington, and please join me in welcoming Ambassador Joseph C. Wilson.
It's always tough to stand up here or sit up here all by yourself while you're listening to these people read all this stuff about you. And wondering who they're talking about. It's as I said on a program with Bill Moyers in the winter of 2003, it was my sincere hope that in my various analyses of the situation as I saw it, that I would be so wrong or be found to be so incorrect in my analysis that I would never be invited back to another foreign policy debate. In listening to what Sandy read about what I wrote several months ago, I fear that perhaps I'm engaged in this debate for a bit longer, even though my own personal preference is to get back to the golf course and work on my next ambition, which is to win a super senior golf tournament on the PGA, and I've got to drop my handicap by about 15 strokes to get there. So I want to thank you, Sandy, very much for that kind introduction. And it's certainly a pleasure for me to be here at the University of California, Berkeley campus. I actually went to school just down the road from here, the University of California, Santa Barbara, shortly after Mario Savio and the free speech movement here. I was a class of 71, so I was down there from 67 to 71. We learned a lot in those years, and I think we built upon the free speech movement, either to our great credit or to our chagrin. One of the things we found out was that here at Berkeley, people finish their rioting by about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, so they get home and study at night. Down there in Santa Barbara at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we were down drinking Red Mountain wine and surfing, not even thinking about what we were going to do until after the sun went down. And as a consequence, even though our demonstrations were as animated as they were up here in Berkeley, those here in Berkeley understood that if you wanted to have a national impact, you had to get your demonstration to the press before they went to bed. In other words, before you had the national newscast. So even when the Bank of America in Santa Barbara was burned, people were still talking about Berkeley, because Berkeley made it under the deadline for the national press, and Santa Barbara didn't burn until about 2 o'clock in the morning. But we never did quite figure out how to spin the press down in Santa Barbara in those days, but we had a good time surfing. I want to talk about, I think, 3 things today and try and draw some conclusions based on my experience, essentially as a citizen of this country, not as a public figure, but as a private citizen who happens to have had a lot of experience in the area of conflict resolution, democratization, and a lot of years overseas. I usually call this speech, as it relates to Iraq, and this conference, of course, deals with Iraq, how do we get into this mess? How do we get out of it? And who decided that his political agenda was more important than the national security of your country and of my country? I'm sort of titling this time, the run-up to the war, the invasion, the conquest, and the aftermath. And let me begin by the run-up to the war. I retired from the Foreign Service in 1998. I retired to my home in Washington, D.C., set up a little business, had my second set of twins, and one of my first set of twins is here in the audience today, my daughter Sabrina, and engaged in private sector activities. Tried to bring American business overseas to places where I had served in 23 years in the Foreign Service, notably Africa, to a certain extent Southern Europe, and to a certain extent the Arab world. I was perfectly happy doing that until the middle of 2002, when Richard Perle, Prince of Darkness they call him, made a speech at the American-Turkish Council in which he laid out the war aims of his particular faction in the U.S. government, the neoconservatives, they call them. I was at that conference because I was chairing a symposium right afterwards. And at that symposium, the point I made in my opening remarks was that if you wanted to follow Richard Perle's advice, we might well find ourselves in a situation within 12 months where the country to the south of Turkey, Iraq, was a chemical, biological, and nuclear wasteland. And if we didn't want to follow his advice, but still wanted to achieve the objective, there may have been other ways of doing it. At that point, I basically made the decision that Richard Perle and his ilk did not deserve a free ride to the invasion, conquest, occupation, regime change scenario that they laid out. And which, by the way, was a blueprint that they had had on the shelf from 1998-1999 in a document called The Project for the New American Century, in which they clearly stated that in order to make this blueprint a reality, we may well need a cataclysmic political event that changes the dynamics in the American body politic and allows us to develop that political will to engage in this particular strategy towards Iraq, regime change strategy. I bitched and moaned about this to friends for a couple of months, and finally somebody said, gee, you really ought to quit griping to us. If you want to do something, start writing. And the San Jose Mercury News gave me an opportunity, so I wrote an article. And in the article, I made the point that, in fact, disarmament is a legitimate objective of the United States. We had had a disarmament policy towards Iraq since the first Gulf War. It was underpinned by international law, notably UN Security Council Resolution 687. And in fact, our activities towards implementing that resolution had been episodic at best since we withdrew the inspectors in 1998 before launching a four-day air assault campaign, actually Tomahawk missile assault campaign known as Desert Fox. And it was important for us to understand that Saddam Hussein was a thug, that he had weapons of mass destruction in the past, and that he had demonstrated capacity of using them, and we should not feel any safer about the situation in the Middle East until such time as we actually brought Saddam into compliance with the disarmament provisions of the UN Security Council resolution and had in place an ongoing monitoring program. Even prior to that, I also articulated to the incoming administration what I thought should be a priority of shifting the sanctions so that the sanctions were more directly focused on the power structure in Iraq and did not have such debilitating effects on the general population. And those of you who have followed this over the years might have read the Council on Foreign Relations study done by Brent Scowcroft and Zbigniew Brzezinski, which articulated precisely that, that we needed to do something that was not so debilitating on the population. Focus sanctions, a revision of the sanctions regime so as to allow people to operate more freely, and a resumption of what I thought would have to be coercive inspections, or muscular disarmament, I called it. The problem with the Bush administration strategy in the first instance was, of course, that it focused on regime change. And a focus on regime change is a rationale for military action. And everybody bought into that, even though we all know that regime change does not automatically translate into going to war as a matter of policy. This administration and previous administrations have long had regime change policies in effect towards countries that we don't like. Cuba comes to mind, Libya before Gaddafi's capitulation comes to mind. And in fact, I like to make the case that even towards my home state of California, this administration had a regime change policy in place. And in fact, that's a pretty good example of what I'm trying to articulate. It does not mean, the fact that this administration had a regime change policy in place towards California, doesn't mean that you mass 130,000 troops on the Nevada-California border and march to Sacramento. It means you get somebody, you use other tools in your toolbox. In this case, you get Darrell Issa to drop a couple million, you get a bunch of people to get petitions, you get a bunch of propaganda, you get a cartoon figure, a caricature to run for governor, and pretty soon you've got regime change. You've got Gray Davis out, and you've got Arnold Schwarzenegger in. For foreign policy buffs, the Reagan administration was pretty good at effecting regime change without marching to Warsaw or without marching to Pretoria, South Africa. And it did it using other tools in his toolbox. A little subversion here, a little propaganda there, a little working with an indigenous group over here, sanctions, other tools in your toolbox. And indeed, I would make the argument that the Iraqi Liberation Act, which some now argue was proof positive of bipartisan consensus that we effect regime change by military action, did not say that at all. The Iraqi Liberation Act said that as a matter of policy, the United States supports regime change in Iraq, and it funded it at $90 million a year. As we now know from the occupation of Iraq, $90 million doesn't buy you a week's worth of meals for 130,000 occupying troops in Iraq. The $90 million that was contemplated was clearly designed to provide us with the funding for the other tools in our toolbox. The other argument that I made was that, of course, if you wanted to go after disarmament, which I felt was appropriate, that you had to be tough as nails with Saddam Hussein, a person unlike most other Americans I actually know. That, in fact, you were going to have muscular diplomacy backed by the credible threat of military force, and in order for that threat of force to be credible, you had to be prepared to use it. But the important thing was to use it in support of the national security objectives that we had defined. And the only legitimate national security objective for using military force against Iraq was the weapons of mass destruction and the potential threat that they posed to the United States of America and our citizens. That did not require an invasion, conquest, and occupation scenario. The extent to which we might have had to use military force, we could have focused it in support of intrusive inspections. And in fact, shortly after my article came out, there was a change in the rhetoric of this administration, not because of the article, but because there was a broad consensus that, in fact, it was important to get some international support for what we intended to do. And as a consequence, it was important to shape the argument in such a way that it was broadly acceptable to the international community. The president made the case to Congress, I think correctly so, that he needed to have a strong hand in going up and negotiating this new resolution with the United Nations. And he got that use of force authorization, if necessary, use of force if necessary. And in making the case that he needed the use of force authorization, he also made the point that military option was the last of his options, not the first, not the second, the last. And that he needed this resolution, as he told, I think, Susan Collins, and then later it was reported in the LA Times, in order to strengthen his hand to go up and whip those international bureaucrats into shape. And he got it, and he went up, and he got 1441. And that was very useful. But by that time, of course, the rhetoric in the United States and the case that was being made and the people that were out on the stump talking about this were beating the war drums. And they were beating the regime change war drums. I debated all of them, Frank Gaffney, Dick Pearl, Ken Edelman. I remember in particular one debate with Edelman in which I said, you know, really disarmament's the objective. It shouldn't be regime change, it should be disarmament. And in fact, we probably wouldn't have to do regime change in order to get disarmament. And Ken Edelman said, well, he doesn't have access to all the intelligence. I thought to myself, well, maybe actually Ken doesn't have all the access to the intelligence, as it turned out. Richard Pearl came up and said that those who were talking about disarmament as an objective and the use of force to support that disarmament objective, if necessary, without engaging in an overt regime change war, that nobody was talking like that, which is patently untrue. In fact, the Carnegie Endowment had just produced a study. And the person who had written the segment on the study dealing with coercive inspections was a fellow by the name of Chuck Boyd. Chuck Boyd was a four-star Air Force general, had been a POW in the Vietnam War. His last tour in the military had been as Deputy Commander-in-Chief of U.S. Armed Forces Europe. He had then gone on to work for Newt Gingrich. This was not some left-wing, starry-eyed idealist. This was a hard-nosed military realist who understood, as many of us did, what the consequences would be of a war that took us into Baghdad and had us occupying Baghdad as we're doing today. Editorial boards by that time had pretty much made up their mind. The editorial board, the editorial page of the Washington Post, with the exception of Mary McGrory and maybe one or two others, Richard Cohen, were beating the drums of war. The only thing we could do in order to deal with this genie out there in the Middle East in the aftermath of 9/11 was go in, invade, conquer, and then occupy. The president and his administration, beginning with Vice President Cheney in August of 2002, started talking up the weapons of mass destruction threat. And they started dissembling. The president made 4 points related to the one weapons of mass destruction threat that is of real strategic concern to the United States, the nuclear threat. Biological weapons are a completely different issue, possibly useful as a tactical battlefield weapon. The weaponization of biological weapons is other than a terror weapon is not at all clear, even to this day. Chemical weapons, the same thing. One of the things about chemical weapons, you've got to be upwind when you deliver it. Nuclear weapons pose the one strategic threat to our national security. The President of the United States made 4 points related to that. One, we can't wait for the smoking gun to be a mushroom cloud. Two, Saddam Hussein is only fissile material away from having a nuclear weapon. Three, we've discovered some aluminum tubes that could be used in centrifuges for the production of, or the enhancement of, the enrichment of uranium for the production of fissile material. And four, of course, we have learned from British intelligence that Iraq has sought significant quantities of uranium from Africa. Now, if you strip away the argument, you come up with no efforts to purchase uranium from Africa. The aluminum tubes, it just so happens, as everybody who knows anything about this, except for one person in the agency, knew, were perfectly matched to retrofit Italian surface-to-surface artillery shells, artillery missiles. And without centrifuges and without fissile material, you don't have, and under this scenario that was articulated by the President of the United States, you don't have nuclear weapons. Now, he didn't argue in his debate that they were out purchasing nuclear weapons on the black market from Russia. And in fact, at the same time that he was making this argument, the administration was starving Nunn-Lugar, which was the bill that was passed to enable us to purchase loose nukes from the former Soviet Union so as to reduce precisely that threat to our national security. Now, these were the four issues. And then the president went on to articulate two other significant reasons why we had to go to war with Iraq. One was operational ties to international terrorism with a global reach. That was his definition after 9/11. It turns out that the only terrorist who might have had ties to Al-Qaeda was located in a part of the country that was out of Saddam Hussein's control, that in fact was protected by the American overflight zone and was up in the northern part of autonomous Kurdistan at that time. And then, of course, the president articulated the link between the two, the possibility that a rogue state like Saddam Hussein might actually transfer weapons of mass destruction to a non-state actor, an international terrorist group. The problem with that argument, of course, is that, among others, the director of Central Intelligence, as well as the National Intelligence Estimate, said that if Saddam were to do that, it would be the last thing he ever did. He would do it only when his regime was on the verge of collapse. In other words, if it was going to happen, it would have happened just as we were arriving at the gates of Baghdad, and as a consequence, has happened. Now, as we now know, now that we're in there, of course, when we went in there, we may have expected that there might have been a weapon of mass destruction attack against us, but we did really very little to secure some of the key sites where weapons of mass destruction might have been, or information relating to them might have been. Which raises a question, was this, in fact, an invasion for the purposes of dealing with the weapons of mass destruction issue as it related to Iraq? It's not me who tells you that, but when the U.S. Army went up the Tigris and Euphrates River valleys, they bypassed the nuclear site known as Tuwaitha, where there was, in fact, yellow cake that was stored under IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency seal. Bypassed it completely, did not secure the site, and did not circle back to secure the site until after there were being broadcast around the world pictures of Iraqi kids who were suffering from severe radiation sickness because they had looted the site and were drinking out of barrels that had contained yellow cake, or were swimming in the barrels, or were washing in the barrels. U.S. forces did not secure, in the initial days in Baghdad, the Iraqi equivalent of the CDC, where there might well have been secreted biological material. And according to Scott Ritter, they did not even secure the site, which was the principal repository of the archives on weapons of mass destruction. But we went. And we went despite the admonitions of the international community that this might not be the best thing we ever decided to do. In fact, as we were having this debate, rather than have a thoughtful debate that we in a democracy know and understand, we went and viciously insulted those whose support, whose very support we need today. The House of Representatives changed French fries to freedom fries. Air Force One changed French toast to freedom toast. And for a while, it was pretty much off limits for me to wear an Hermes tie on television, unless I really wanted to thumb my nose at my interviewer, which, by the way, generally I did. And now, of course, just several months later, you have a headline in the National Journal saying, gee, the French were right. The problem was not going up and getting 1441. The problem was not accepting yes for an answer. And here, the media, even as the editorial pages, had long since decided that regime change as a rationale for military action was the course that we should follow. When Colin Powell went up and spoke at the United Nations, the headlines the next day, Fort Lauderdale Press, smoking gun. Richard Cohen, Mary McGrory on the editorial pages of the Washington Post. Okay, I'm convinced now. And yet if you go back today and you read Colin Powell's statement, don't go back and watch the theatrical performance, which was masterful. But go back and read his statement. First of all, he begins by saying, this is all about disarmament. He doesn't say what the president is now saying is the principal justification for the war, that Saddam was a bad man, madman, therefore we had to do him in. He's saying disarmament. And then he says the following. We have information that Saddam Hussein has secreted scientists in neighboring countries so that they can't be investigated or can't be interrogated by the inspectors. Or we have information that Saddam Hussein has threatened to kill any scientists that are interviewed by inspectors. The files that we want to take a look at are loaded on the backs of trucks and are being transported around the country so that they don't fall into the hands of the inspectors. We have inspectors going through the palaces. People who are working on weapons of mass destruction are busy cleaning the suspected sites. We have satellite photos telling us everything that's going on the ground, and by the way, we have tape recordings so that we can hear everything that's being said. That was the essence of Colin Powell's statement, and that is what produced the headlines the next day, the smoking gun headlines. Did anybody bother to go out and ask an inspector his interpretation of what Powell said? Did anybody go out and ask an expert on disarmament about the meaning of what Powell said? If they did, I certainly didn't see it in any newspapers, but we did. Pat Lang, a man of 30 years' experience in the Middle East, was actually out in Kuwait. He talked to an inspector right afterwards. They watched the speech. The inspector said to Pat, Powell's got nothing. Intelligence analysts who took a look at it understood that even for Powell's statements, that everything was so carefully caveated that it was subject to interpretation. But even without that, I actually went out and talked to somebody who does disarmament for a living. And what he said to me was, you know what? In our business, disruption is a significant measure of success. In other words, what Powell was saying is 1441 was working. Because look at what he said. Scientists are out of the country or threatened with death. That means they're either not at their laboratories doing R&D on weapons of mass destruction, or likely they're pretty dysfunctional. People who are working on weapons of mass destruction programs are busy cleaning the sites. What does that mean? It means they're not putting chemical weapons in artillery shells. They're sweeping floors. The files are being transported around the country in trucks. What does that mean? Well, anybody who works in our sort of environment knows that without your files, you're about as bad off as you are without your secretary. You can't do anything. We have people going through his sites everywhere we want. We've got photographs of everything. Bill Owens, who used to be the deputy chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, said that it was certainly within our capability to put a complete intelligence umbrella over Iraq. We're listening to what he has to say. That is all evidence of significant disruption of his weapons of mass destruction program. Significant disruption is a significant measure of success. And yet the headlines and the editorial writers all gleefully talking about the smoking gun. I think poor Mary McGrory, I think, came to regret that and has not written a word pretty much since. We went to war. The coverage of the war, from our perspective, was really something to behold. And I've said repeatedly that if there's one thing that I regret in my particular life, it has been that we did not give our full due of support for our veterans when they came back from the Vietnam War. That we confused those who had taken the orders of their political masters and done their duty with those who had executed those orders, who had made that policy that led to their orders. We certainly didn't do that this time, and I'm glad of that. I had the privilege of working as political advisor to the Commander-in-Chief of U.S. Armed Forces when we went to Bosnia. I've had the experience in now, I think, 3 or 4 wars, and the U.S. military is something to behold. And they need to be supported. More to the point, we as citizens need to ensure that our government, when it undertakes the most solemn obligation of sending our sons and daughters, our young men and our young women, to die and to kill for our country, that we as a society have decided that that is what we need to do to ensure our own national security. We did not do that in this case. More to the point, in the particular coverage, we got great shots of Walt Rogers and David Bloom before he passed away, driving up the Tigris and Euphrates River valleys, in the back of Abrams tanks and Bradley fighting vehicles. And we got great views of shock and awe as briefed to us by the Pentagon, what great precision bombing we were doing. And in fact, it was pretty good. What we didn't get is shock and awe viewed by the shocked and the awed. And I don't know about you, but I spent a fair amount of time during the war looking at Al Jazeera and other sites, BBC even, who were producing a different set of images and a different set of reactions. Why? Because it is at our own peril that we neglect to understand or to learn about the impact of our actions on other societies. If we don't understand that a son and a daughter to an Iraqi mother or father is as important as a son or a daughter to us, then there are key lessons that we fail to learn, and we will be in for very nasty surprises down the road. We had seduced ourselves into believing the mellifluous tones of Vice President Cheney when he said we would be greeted as liberators. We failed to understand that for most Iraqis, we were just another foreign occupier, of which they have known many in their history. And as a consequence, here we are in a situation that if we do not succeed completely, we fail. And if we fail, we will be blamed for that failure forever. And ladies and gentlemen, forever in that part of the world where they remember the fall of the caliphate to the Mongols in 1258, as if it were yesterday, forever is a long, long time. We failed to learn that. Our press failed to tell us that. The challenges to the cakewalk and cheering from the rooftop crowd were minimal, disregarded, and just generally dismissed by the really clever marketing arm of the pro-war crowd. I can count half a dozen people who claim to be experts who know nothing about the region. In fact, I just debated Bill Kristol down in Midland, Texas last week, heart of Bush country. Somebody actually asked the question, well, Bill, how much time have you spent in the region? To which Bill had to answer, gee, not very much at all. Book learning, if that. And yet people like Bill Kristol would just go ahead and dismiss people like myself, who actually happen to have some on-the-ground experience. What does he know? Nobody's talking about coercive containment. Nobody's talking about muscular disarmament. It'll be a cakewalk. They'll be cheering from the rooftops. We did not get that debate before we went in, and as a consequence, there we are now. In the aftermath, and I will be brief on this, what have we got from ourselves and from our press? Study after study has shown that we're headed towards a civil war in Iraq. And yet it is literally only in the last few days that you've had Dan Rather and this morning Walt Rogers begin to talk about briefings that they're getting on the ground about the extent to which the situation in Baghdad is terribly precarious. There's a poll out talking about Iraqi attitudes, and you can be darn sure that the Bush administration is going to be talking about, well, you see, the polls show that most of the Iraqis, or a good half of the Iraqis, think we're better off today than we were a year ago. But if you go to the internals of that poll, you will find that, in fact, you're talking about the Kurds, who are 80% supportive of what we've done, and the Arabs, who are far less than half. And why are the Kurds happy? Because they don't understand that they may well be on the eve of the third great betrayal of the Kurdish nation in the last century. When at some point we have to make the decision as to whether or not our strategic ally in the region is Turkey or Kurdistan. Will we defy Turkey in order for the Kurds to take Kirkuk? I think not. So the euphoria there is very short-lived. And what does this mean for us as we go forward? It means, first of all, we're still asking the wrong questions. We're still not discussing this in a way that makes sense in the context of our national security. And you will see John Burns, I think it's tomorrow, and he will tell you, as many have done, that it was a good war because the Iraqis are better off because Saddam Hussein was a tyrant. Yes, he was indeed a tyrant. But now the mess that's left over is our mess. We own it. Ahmed Shalabi will tell you that it was worth $150 billion, as he said, on frontline, and 600 American lives because it got him back to Baghdad. Ahmed Shalabi will also tell you, as he told the London Telegraph, that they are heroes of error, acknowledging the extent to which they engaged in deceptive practices in order to foment this war against Iraq. This is a story that still needs to be written. This may well be the greatest flim-flam in the history of the world. And when you look at Shalabi staffing out the cabinet with his cronies in all those positions that make money, and you see what he's doing with his children and his nephews and his neoconservative buddies, here is a guy who is hedging all of his bets. He will either have power, or he will have money, or he will have both. And it comes out of your pockets, and your kids' pockets, and my pockets. And I believe that a harbinger, by the way, as I say, and I often make predictions, as I did in some of these articles the other day, if you want to know where Iraq is going in the next 6 months, check out where Ahmed Shalabi spends his time. If he's spending his time in the London clubs, well, Iraq is really going downhill rather quickly. And I think that that's what you will end up seeing. When my friend Wolf Blitzer continues to ask the question and challenge people that he interviews by saying, well, you have to admit, Iraq is better off without Saddam Hussein. Iraq is better off today than it was a year ago. Well, that's the wrong question, my friends, because the real question is, are we better off? Are we better off owning the potential for instability in the heart of the Middle East for the foreseeable future? Are we better off having undertaken an action, one of the results of which might be the exponential growth in 19-year-old Arab males who hate us so much and are so unemployed and so underemployed that they're prepared to try and kill us and to die in order to attain paradise, whose futures are seen in such bleak terms, and to whom they can blame the United States, as they are going to be doing increasingly? And what does this mean? What does this mean to us as we really look at the role of the press in an election year? And I look at this as I've followed this in the last year and a half, and I frankly think that our press is under a lot of stress and under a lot of pressure. Part of it's the Patriot Act. Part of it is the aggressive nature of this administration to define the stories that are told and to refuse to answer questions on subjects that they just simply want to move on from. If you remember Ari Fleischer, the president has moved on. Now, there are a couple of other instances that I'm involved with where the press has been perhaps not as diligent or not as aggressive in investigating as perhaps I would have liked for other reasons. And some of the statements of the press to me have been rather enlightening as we go forward. One fellow said that he would report on this particular issue, but if he did so, he'd end up in Guantanamo. Guantanamo doesn't mean that he would actually end up down there, but it's a metaphor for his being frozen out of dealing with the White House. Another one said that you need to understand that these people have houses and mortgages and kids in private school, and they don't want to jeopardize that by going to the heart of the story. Now, this is a journalism school, and I would submit to you that most of you are not being taught that investigative journalism is all about houses and mortgages and private schools for your kids. That it is, in fact, about getting to what Mark Feynman used to call the dirtball stories. Mark Feynman was a foreign correspondent for the LA Times, who passed away in Baghdad, one of the finest journalists that I knew in my beat in Baghdad. Getting to the truth. Afflicting the comfortable and comforting the afflicted. And if you don't do that, you are complicit in comforting the comfortable and afflicting the afflicted. And that's where we are now. And in being complicit in that, we undermine some of our most cherished freedoms. Because a democracy will not long endure if the freedom of its press is circumscribed. It will not long endure if, in fact, it is so cowed by the executive branch that it will not write those dirtball stories. It will not go after the truth. It will not continue to pursue the deception on weapons of mass destruction, Ahmed Shalabi's flim-flam, the lack of lies to terrorism, the sweetheart contracts to Halliburton and to Bechtel, the role played by the neoconservatives and who they are. Has anybody seen a biography in any newspaper on David Wormser? These guys are key people in developing the strategy. And if you don't do that, if we don't do that, we're complicit in the undermining of our own democracy. Now, let me leave you with one quote. Phil Graham talking about Democrats. We're going to keep building the Republican Party until we're hunting Democrats with dogs. Now, I suggest to you that once they succeed in doing that, journalists will not be far behind. Karl Rove himself once said about my wife, she's fair game. Journalists will not be far behind. And don't take my word for it, just because I've lived and served in dictatorships from Franco's Spain to Saddam Hussein's Iraq and any number of African dictatorships. Talk to people like my friend Lamis Andoni, who was one of the most courageous journalists that I've ever met in my career, somebody who was actually face down autocratic governments and autocratic regimes in her pursuit of the truth. If we don't do it for ourselves, we at a minimum have to do it for the basic institutions and the basic freedoms that we represent. I have seen journalists thrown in jail. I have seen them tortured. I have had friends of mine who have been killed for their beliefs. It is something that you have to fight from the beginning, because it is that much tougher to fight at the end. And again, don't take my word for it. Take the word of those who have been engaged in this struggle around the world for generations. Thank you. Thank you. All right, let's mix it up. Let's get some questions.
We've got time for about four or five questions, and if you could wait until Emily reaches you with the microphone, and please make your questions brief because we don't have that much time.
Right over there.
Just in today's New York Times, we see the Pew Charitable Trust survey reported finding many Middle East nations believing that the primary motivation for going into Iraq was to obtain access to the oil. I'd be interested in your comment on that, the extent to which you think that was a motivation for Bush-Cheney, but also in light of the fact that the Bush administration is committed to giving up political control of Iraq, what is their game plan for protecting access to oil resources in Iraq?
Sure. Okay. Well, I've always believed that that the real motivation, I wrote about this in The Nation magazine, was to change the dynamics in the Middle East. And that's effectively what Bill Kristol said the other day. We didn't have that debate, by the way, before we got into the war. We're $150 billion and 600 dead Americans into this, and we still haven't had that debate as to whether that's a useful use of our military to do that, change the dynamics. But that said, my experience in the third world, or my experience in international diplomacy and defending and promoting American foreign interests overseas, my experience in recently decolonized Africa, has been that vested commercial, parochial interests in a foreign land always trump strategic interests when push comes to shove. And so my judgment on this is that we are establishing a whole host of vested interests there, pumping billions of dollars into these vested interests, and that will come back to play a role in the decisions that we make going forward. Now, the argument that I tried to make in the run-up to the war was that we had already succeeded in doing what I thought was probably a legitimate strategic objective, and that is enhancing our security posture vis-a-vis some of the strategic assets in the region. We had set up status of forces agreements or real bases. And that whole area up the east side of the Arabian Peninsula, from Yemen all the way up to some of these Emirates, and all the way across, frankly, into the stands. We had more than enough coverage, and when Wolfowitz says that we had to go to war in order to be able to pull our troops out of Saudi Arabia, that is being disingenuous, to say the least. We had already set up precisely what we needed to provide, not over-the-horizon coverage, which was what traditionally we provided, but really boots on the ground in countries neighboring Saudi Arabia, countries that wanted us. Wanted us because they feared their big neighbors to the northeast and to the west, Iran and Saudi Arabia. The extent to which this turns into a calamity that has a negative spillover effect on the part of significant populations in these countries, it's hard for us to maintain presence when the natives are getting restless outside the door. Let's see that lady right next to you.
I'm working with the National Coalition to Impeach Bush and Cheney. And the Constitution provides impeachment for alleged criminals in office. They took us into an aggressive war without imminent threat. That violates the UN Charter, which is a part of the supreme law of this land. Furthermore, outing, I understand, a CIA officer is a felony. These are high crimes and misdemeanors which the Constitution allows us to use impeachment to go against those people who have committed it. Our feeling is that even if impeachment proceedings should be started by our representatives in the House, that even if that wasn't completed before the election, that it would help to show in the public's mind that these are criminal actions that are impeachable. So I'd like you to comment on that.
Okay. My view of that is that the appropriate place to deal with this issue, given the fact that we don't own either of the houses in Congress, is at the ballot box. And when I come out and speak at campuses, if there is a lesson from my own personal experience, it is that our democracy really does count, and it is long past time for us to take it back. It's an abomination that we are ruled by such a small minority of the adult population. Essentially the evangelical right and the neoconservative coalition. My own judgment is that if you get more voters, you get a broader base of support. Yeah, one of these two right here.
Hi, given your extensive foreign policy experience, I would just like you to comment on the significance of the recent election in Spain, the Zapatero the ascension of the socialists, which I think, and also the implications of that election on this coalition in this so-called war on terror.
Sure, you bet. Well, I think it's a very clear signal to other governments that have decided to throw their lot in with the United States that there are risks associated with that, and governments and political entities like to survive as long and as in as powerful position as possible. This is a keen signal to them that your better chances of survival. Your chances of survival are enhanced if you put some distance between yourself and the United States. How that impacts on what I think is the leading edge of the war on terrorism, which is international cooperation on such matters as intelligence sharing, police sharing, financial contraventions. We were talking earlier with somebody about the ability to monitor export controls, for example. It may just suddenly become politically much more difficult. The road to that sort of cooperation may be less smooth because there may well be political roadblocks as a consequence of that. The problem with this, of course, is that if you get the Spanish pulling out and you get everybody pulling out, it really is coming home to roost, our unilateral actions. We will be stuck with this all by ourselves, and it is a mess. The only way, in my judgment, to get through Iraq and possibly have a chance of succeeding, and that door of opportunity closes every day that Don Rumsfeld's in office, is if we can persuade our friends and allies that it's in all of our interests, as indeed it is, that Iraq succeed, and we get enough people and enough people from different nations into Iraq to be able to be persuasive to the Iraqis that, in fact, this is a global reconstruction effort designed to help them in their time of need after 35 years of Ba'athist tyranny, three wars, and, of course, shock and awe. And unless you do that, it will always be seen by the Iraqis as a foreign occupation force. So the threat of withdrawal of the Spanish, it seems to me, should be a cause of considerable alarm to the United States and to our national security interests. I would argue that the time has long since passed to have an extraordinary summit of NATO, of the OAS, and of ASEAN, and any other regional organization that has provided troops. So in order to get an overarching sort of legal imprimatur on what we're doing. And that will mean, of course, that the United States will have to modify some of its objectives to accommodate those objectives of others. Yes, sir.
I may not have got this exactly right, but some of your initial comments you made seem to imply that some kinds of involvement in other countries to affect their political systems would be appropriate, short of military engagement. And if there are such methods that you think are appropriate, could you specify what they would be to get involved in other the governmental work of other
you
countries?
You bet, yeah. And of course, when you're out here in California, I actually was out here several months ago talking to a group of religious social workers down in Los Angeles. It turned out that it was all the crowd that had fought the CIA from the time of Allende all the way up through South America and Latin America, Nicaragua, and everywhere else for close to 30 years. And I came back to Washington. I was able to report to a CIA friend of mine, who will otherwise remain unnamed, that in fact, in meeting with this group, I'd found that they'd actually discovered something they hated more than the CIA, and that was a government that would actually out their own CIA agent. But with respect to this, I think it's important to understand we do have legitimate national security interests, and we do have legitimate enemies and adversaries throughout the world. And there are times when the power of persuasion do not work. And there are times when those threats are so grave to our national security that other actions need to be taken. And we have a whole host of tools in our toolbox. And they range from everything like economic sanctions against the apartheid regime of South Africa, or sanctions on the regime of Sudan, for example, to subversion. Now, whether you like it or not, and we all have our own views on various activities to subvert or overthrow regimes in other countries, those are the tools at our disposal. And those are the tools at any leader's disposal. And each case, obviously, has got to be debated on its merits. There's some things that I would have liked to have seen us do more aggressively, for example. I can think of many in Africa that might have, in fact, the risk was for more than outweighed by the potential benefit of achieving some success. Everybody's got their own views on Latin America and other issues as well. But we have the whole panoply. My point in making this argument is that war always, the frontal, brutal assault, always is considered to be our last option. And one of the reasons it's considered to be the last option is because the only thing you control in war is the firing off of the first shot. And the potential for unintended consequences are enormous. And we're just beginning to see that in Iraq.
Last question.
Tony Blair.
Well, has Tony come out of his bathroom yet? I understand that after the Spanish elections, he took to his bed, was last seen sucking his thumb. I thought that Prime Minister Blair had actually articulated the case for strong international action based upon a general international consensus as to what the threat was posed by Saddam's regime. Irrespective of whether you found weapons of mass destruction, the going in position was that Saddam Hussein had not complied with 687, and that it was important, not compliance. Compliance is not a reason to go to war. Impatience is not a reason to go to war. The threat to our national security posed by weapons of mass destruction is a reason to adopt a policy and a set of actions. I think Tony Blair understood that. My own judgment is that the British have long since made a decision that their future lies in an alliance with the United States, right or wrong. I also think that Mr. Blair concluded that the best way that he could possibly influence U.S. policy was to be seen to be standing shoulder to shoulder with the President of the United States. I think he was very effective in getting, at least rhetorically, the focus off regime change as a rationale for military action and on to disarmament as a rationale for international action. The problem for Mr. Blair was that he was double-crossed. He thought he was in a disarmament campaign and ended up with Dick Pearl's Dirty Little War.
Sorry, we don't have time for more questions, but please.
Thank you all very much.